gotten past the Sermon on the Mount, and we have to run through a lot of other material in Matthew. I'm not going to make any attempt to cover the other material, anything like we covered the Sermon on the Mount. Sermon on the Mount is a favorite part of the Bible for me. We covered it extremely quickly from my way of seeing things, but we still took longer than we can take with the other materials ahead of us. When we come out of that, we have the people's reaction to Jesus' teaching is recorded in verse 28. When he'd finished saying these things, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who having authority and not as the scribes. People were surprised that Jesus spoke as if he had authority. Now, what's that mean? As if he didn't have to depend on the authority of somebody else. Almost all the scribes, when they taught in the synagogues, made a habit of quoting other rabbis who were respected before themselves. One scholar I read said that among Jewish teachers there was no value placed in being novel or being original. They wanted to show that they were on board with all that the Orthodox rabbis had said before. So they would quote other rabbis and say, this is so because Rabbi so-and-so says so and so on. Jesus didn't quote any rabbis. He just said, the rabbi said this, but I say this. And what I say is more important than what they say. You're going to learn something from me that you won't learn from the rabbis. As if he had some insight of his own. As if he had some authority to speak for God that the rabbis never claimed for themselves. And Jesus did have that authority, obviously. There's an interesting story about Jesus casting out demons in a synagogue on the Sabbath. It's found in Matthew and Mark, but in Mark's gospel, it's interesting because it says in that pericope, it starts by saying the people were amazed when Jesus taught because he spoke as if he had authority. Then immediately after he cast out a demon and said, then they marveled and said, he has authority over the demons. And you see, a person can speak as if they have authority when they really don't. There's a lot of people who are dogmatic in their preaching. And they act as if, you know, you should see it their way or no way. And they speak as if they have authority, but do they really? Anyone can talk like they know everything if they have the chutzpah to do so. But how do you know if they really have authority? In the case of Jesus, people marveled that he spoke as one who has authority. But did he have authority? Or was he just talking like he did? Well, by casting out demons and doing other things, he proved that he had authority. And one of those things comes out in chapter 8 when the centurions, I better take the earlier story. There's several stories. The first story of chapter 8 is 1 through 4. Jesus heals a leper. The important thing to notice about that is that he touched the leper. And the leper was cleansed. Now, this is something Jesus did that Jews didn't do. Jews don't touch lepers. They don't touch dead bodies if they can help it. They don't touch women who have issues of blood. The reason they don't do these things is because those things rendered people unclean under the Jewish law. If you were a woman who had your period, you were unclean during that time. If a person there was a dead body, it was unclean. A leper was unclean. There's all kinds of conditions that could render somebody unclean. And if something was unclean, you didn't want to touch it because you would become unclean. Under the Jewish law, if you touch a leper or a dead body or a woman who has an issue of blood, you became unclean. And what that meant is you can't go into the tabernacle. You can't even sleep with your family at home until you're clean again. Some things, contact with them made you unclean for a day, and you'd be unclean until night time. Other times you'd be unclean for a whole week. And sometimes you'd be unclean for an open-ended period of time, like a leper is unclean until he gets better, and that might be never. But uncleanness always barred you from access to the tabernacle or temple, and therefore by implication from God, and also from family relations and so forth. You had to be away from those who were clean so that you wouldn't defile them. Now Jesus, when he encountered unclean people, he never cared about this clean, unclean business. He touched them when he didn't have to. Jesus could heal somebody from a distance without laying eyes on them. He could tell them, be well, and they'd be well. But Jesus went out of his way to touch unclean people. It obviously was a demonstration of something he was doing. And what was he demonstrating? He was demonstrating that there's a new power, a new dynamic in his ministry that did not exist in the old covenant. In the old covenant, if you came into contact with the unclean, you became unclean. Jesus came into contact with the unclean, and they became clean. He didn't become unclean. His cleanness transferred to them. Instead, their uncleanness transferred to him. Now, clean and unclean were simply symbolic conditions in the rituals of Judaism. Being unclean ceremonially didn't really put you at odds with God. I mean, being a leper doesn't mean God didn't like you or that you couldn't really pray or couldn't go to heaven. It just meant that in these ceremonies that were to symbolize certain spiritual things, it was a state of that debarred you from certain social and religious activities, and therefore symbolically indicated that real uncleanness, which is spiritual, not ceremonial, real sin, separates you from God and from man. It breaks relationships. But unclean ritual states were not real sin. They were symbolic conditions that represented sin and taught lessons about sin. And therefore, when God told Israel not to touch these things, is because he's implying that if you are in contact with sinners, they'll make you sinners. When God told Israel, when you go into Canaan, don't leave any Canaanites there. Get rid of them all because they will infect you with their idolatry. And sure enough, it happened. God had to tell Israel under the old covenant to kill off the Canaanites rather than live among them and evangelize them. Because the Israelites did not, under the old covenant, have the dynamic that came with Jesus into the world. Contact with sinners simply made them sinners. But Jesus brought a new dynamic to his disciples in the new covenant, and he said, you go out now to the sinners, and you reach them. You evangelize them. You're going to infect them now. Israel would be infected by contact with the Canaanites, but we are not infected by contact with the world. We're sent out to infect the world with what we have. And that's what Jesus demonstrated. His new covenant had a power and a dynamic that did not exist in the old covenant. And he demonstrated that on purpose by touching people who were not supposed to be touched. But who could say he was unclean once the leper was no longer a leper? He touched a leper and said, okay, Jesus, you can't go to the tabernacle because you just touched a leper. Jesus, where's the leper? I don't see a leper. Do you see a leper? There's no leper here. You know? Well, you just touched that woman with an issue of blood. She touched you. You're unclean. Really? Where is a woman with the issue of blood? There's no woman here with an issue of blood. She's healed. Jesus' cleanness became their cleanness by contact. And that is the difference between the old covenant and the new. And I think Jesus, in doing this kind of thing, which he didn't have to do, he could heal the person without touching, but he did it on purpose to make such a point, I believe. And now, also in chapter 8, we have an interesting story about a man who was a centurion, which was a Roman officer over 100 soldiers. Centurion means over 100, just like a century is 100 years. A centurion is a man who's an officer over 100 soldiers. He was not a Jew, and therefore he was not well loved by the Jews because he was part of the occupational pagan army that kept Israel under its heel. Now, this man was a better Roman than most. In fact, when you read the parallel to this in Luke, it says that some Jews came to Jesus and recommended that this man was worthy to receive a help from Jesus because this centurion had helped build them a synagogue and had done good things to the Jews. Most Romans did not. But they were Romans nonetheless, and therefore they were unclean. And a Jew would not go into the home of a Gentile because too many unclean things were in a Gentile's home, and a Jew just wouldn't go in there. But this man came to Jesus and said, I have a servant who's dying, would you heal him? And Jesus said, I'll come over to your house and heal him. And the man said, I'm not worthy to have you in my house. You're a Jew, I'm a Gentile, I'm sure that would be a violation of some code that you have, so I'm not going to ask you to do that. I want you just to give the word and heal him from here. He says, I know you can do that because I also understand authority. I'm an officer. I have people above me and below me. I'm a man under authority, and I have servants below me and soldiers. I say, do this, they do it. I say, go there, and they go. In other words, I understand that you are like me, Jesus. You're under proper authority. That's Jesus under the authority of God. And you've got the authority to speak things that will be done on your behalf without you doing it yourself. Just like I, as an officer, can tell people, go do that. It'll get done. You, Jesus, I'm sure you have authority like that. You can just say, be healed, and he'll be healed from here. You don't have to go do it yourself. Now, this man was actually saying all of this out of deference to Christ, out of respect to Christ, saying, you know, I don't want to ask you to do something that, like, defile yourself by coming to my unclean house. I'm not worthy of that, but I know you have the authority that you can do this. And Jesus marveled. He said, I've not seen this faith in all Israel. Now, that's a tremendous contrast between a Gentile and all Israel. Israel's the Jews. He's saying, here I am, the King of the Jews, the Messiah of Israel, and I don't have the Israelites showing this kind of faith in me that I see in this Gentile who's a pagan. And then Jesus said, and this is not going to be the only case. There will be many who will come from the east and the west and sit down in the kingdom of heaven with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But the children of the kingdom, or the heirs of the kingdom, meaning the Jews, will be cast out where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And they told the man his servant was well, and sure enough he was. He healed the man. And so this story shows that Jesus had authority. Even this Roman recognized he had authority. The people knew that Jesus spoke like somebody who had authority, but did he really have it? Well, here's one case where he clearly demonstrated that he did. And the Roman knew that this was a matter of authority. You have the authority, Jesus. You can say it and it'll get done. And Jesus said, you're right about that. It's done. And Jesus proved he had the authority, which he represented himself in his speaking to have. He demonstrated it with his actions. Now, we then have Jesus healing Peter's mother-in-law. This happened actually after a synagogue service. And Jesus healed her of a fever. And as a result of that, a whole bunch of people brought their sick to him. Now, they waited until after sunset because this was a Sabbath. He had been in the synagogue that morning teaching on the Sabbath. He healed Peter's mother-in-law privately, and then people wanted him to heal all their sick, so they waited till sundown because a man's not supposed to heal on the Sabbath, not supposed to do any work on the Sabbath. Although Jesus did, he healed Peter's mother-in-law on the Sabbath. Jesus didn't have any hang-ups about that, but the people did. So after sundown, they brought all their sick, and Jesus went long into the night, healing all their sick, casting out demons, doing all kinds of miracles for them. Now, they wanted him to stay, but the next morning he left to make an itinerary around Galilee, doing all kinds of things. And in verses 18 through 22, we see a couple of disciples, or would-be disciples, coming to him, who wanted to follow him, apparently. But there were issues. It says in verse 18, now when Jesus saw great crowds around him, he gave orders to go over to the other side. That is, he's going to take the boat across the lake. A scribe then approached and said, teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Another of his disciples said to him, Lord, first let me go bury my father. But Jesus said to him, follow me and let the dead bury their own dead. Now, there was a third man on this occasion that Luke mentions who also said, I will follow you, but let me first go say goodbye to those of my household. And Jesus said, no man putting his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. So Matthew mentions two of these men. Luke mentions a third one. All of them, it would appear, may not have ended up being disciples. We don't read whether they accepted his terms or not. We can see that they were ready prior to hearing his terms to follow him, but he seemed to be willing to put them off a little bit. It's like Jesus wasn't like the modern church growth pastor who wants everybody to come to his movement. He only wanted people to come on the right terms, people who were ready to be real disciples. If not, he just assumed they left. We see this in the case of the rich young ruler. Here's a rich man who is a synagogue ruler who'd kept the law from his youth. The man had a great reputation, a godly man, rich, powerful. What a guy to have in your church. Most churches would let this guy be an elder. They beg him to be an elder because they give positions like that to people they don't want to get rid of. They don't want the person to be able to lead. You get a rich guy who's got a good reputation, who's a powerful person in society, and he comes and wants to be in your church. Well, most pastors say, come on in. Jesus said, wait. You first have to sell what you have to give to the poor, then you can come. And the man wouldn't. And so Jesus let him go. Jesus was not interested in filling the ranks of his followers with people who were not willing to pay the price of discipleship. And he seems to kind of put these people off. Two of the three, only one of them mentioned in Matthew here, but the other one mentioned in Luke, also said, Lord, I'll follow you, but let me first do this. Let me first say goodbye to those in my house. Let me first bury my father. And that's the problem many people have when they want to follow Jesus. They want me first. Lord, I'll follow you, but let me first. Let me be first. My agenda first. I know what I want with my life, and if you're okay with that, Jesus, I'll go with you. Just so I don't have to stop being me first. No, you can't follow Jesus if it's going to be me first. It's got to be Jesus all. Not even Jesus first. Some people say, well, Jesus has to be the most important thing in your life. No, he's got to be your whole life. Paul said, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then we will appear with him in glory. For me to live is Christ. Jesus isn't the first priority on a list of priorities in life. He's the only priority. Seek first the kingdom of God. You won't have to seek anything else out of that. Everything else will be added to you. Jesus has got to be everything, or he's not really what he's supposed to be to you at all. And so these people were not really ready to come without an agenda. They had things they wanted to do first, and Jesus slowed them down, to say the least. Now, they might have met those conditions and become followers. We don't know, because Jesus had many unnamed, for us, followers. We know the names of the 12 because they're named for us, but many followers of Jesus, including 70 that he sent out on a mission once in Luke 10, we don't know their names, but there were lots of people who followed Jesus. Whether these guys kept following Jesus after this or not, we don't know. But the implication, I think, is a little bit that they weren't quite ready, and Jesus sensed that. You know, you think you're ready to go, but what about this? You know, foxes have places to sleep, birds have places to sleep, but I don't have places. You want to sleep under the stars every night? Not have a bed under your... Well, maybe he did. Maybe not. But I think Jesus said it because he figured the guy hadn't counted the cost and needed to. Whether he followed Jesus after that or not, we do not know. Then in chapter 8 further, Jesus crosses the lake, and he's going across the lake to encounter the man of the tombs. Or actually, Matthew tells us two men of the tombs. Mark and Luke mention this story too, but they only mention one man. Matthew remembers more detail, or records more detail, and says there were two men, demon-possessed men, fierce demon-possessed, dangerous demon-possessed men. These guys could break chains when they're chained up, and they were ferocious. People steered clear of that area. They lived in the tombs, which was an unclean place for a Jew to live. And they were probably Jews, because Jesus was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel initially. Jewish men who were totally possessed, and no one could do anything for them, so they just had to be banished from society. And they were tormented. They cut themselves with stones. They cried out at the moon every night. They were like animals. And Jesus went across there to deliver them. But on the way across, a storm arose. And before Jesus got to where these men were, there was a storm that rose that threatened to sink the ship. And of course, Jesus stilled the storm with a word. Psalm 107 tells us it's Yahweh who does that. If you read Psalm 107, it says, "All that men would praise Yahweh for his deeds among men." He talks about those who sail in ships, who do business at the seas, see the works of the Lord. The sea rises up and swells, and they're at their wits' end. And he speaks, and it calms it, and they're at their desired haven. It says in Psalm 107. That's about Yahweh. Jesus, it sounded like the story of Jesus here. Even when Jesus stilled the storm, the disciples freaked out. They said, "What kind of man is this that he commands the wind and the waves?" And they obey him. What's interesting about this is that Jesus didn't just still the storm. He rebuked the storm as if it had a personality. He also had rebuked the fever in Peter's mother-in-law. Usually when Jesus rebuked someone, it was a person or a demon. But rebuking a storm, rebuking a fever... Most of the healings he did didn't involve him rebuking a sickness. Many scholars believe that in these two cases, we're to understand there were demons involved. That Peter's mother-in-law was afflicted by a demon that was giving her this fever, and Jesus rebuked it. In this case, the storm may very well have been caused by satanic or demonic power. After all, Jesus was on his way over to deliver one of Satan's chief captives, one of his most notable victims. And in order to prevent that, it may well be that the devil stirred up a storm to sink the boat before Jesus could get there. But Jesus rebuked it, and it obeyed him just like a personal being would. And therefore, some feel it's possible that this storm was not an ordinary storm, but one that was generated by demonic hostility. Then Jesus, of course, finds these two men of the tombs, and he casts the demons out. In this case, he casts the demons into a herd of pigs, and the pigs... go berserk, and they go over a cliff into water, and die, and therefore they have cost a lot of money to somebody. And when the people of the town come out and see Jesus, they tell him to go away. And they see the man of the tombs all normal now, and they're afraid. It's funny because the Bible says they were afraid of the man of the tombs before, when he was demon-possessed. But now they see him normal, dressed in his right mind, and they're even more afraid because something amazing has happened. Same thing with the disciples in the boat. When the storm was coming on the boat to sink it, the disciples were fearful. But when Jesus rebuked it, then they were very much afraid. It's interesting how people are afraid of danger, but then they're even more afraid sometimes of the supernatural, which might even alleviate the danger. Just because it's eerie. If you see someone who can command a storm and it stops, it kind of gives you the creeps. That's a different kind of fear than the fear of actual danger. The fear of danger is a natural, visceral reaction that even animals have to danger. Animals are afraid of danger too, and rightly so. You need to be afraid of danger so you can avoid it, so you can run away from it if necessary. But there's another kind of fear that isn't of danger. It's just of what is spooky. There's no real danger. C.S. Lewis said, he compared this with, he said, if I said there's a tiger in the next room, you might have a sensation of fear, especially if you're thinking of opening the door and going into that room. But he said, if I said there's a ghost in the next room, you'd probably also feel fear, but not because a ghost can do anything to you, just because it's a ghost. Spooky, you know? A tiger can kill you. A ghost, what do they do to people? For all we know, nothing. But it's spooky. It's scary. There's a fear of the unknown. There's a fear of what's called the numinous, which is not the dangerous, but it's a real fear. And it causes some people to avoid spiritual things altogether. The disciples were afraid of the storm sinking the ship, but they were more afraid of Jesus when he stopped the storm. The people of Gadara were afraid of the demon possession when they were dangerous, but they're even more afraid when they saw him sitting in their right mind. It was too weird. Something supernatural has happened. I can't get a handle on this. I feel like I'm out of my element. I don't understand. I feel insecure. And that kind of fear we see often in the Gospels when people encounter Jesus' miracles. In chapter 9, Jesus heals this man who's paralyzed, who's lowered down through the roof by his four friends in a house. Jesus is in Capernaum, probably in Peter's house in all likelihood. And the house is so crowded, these men are bringing their paralyzed friend, and they can't get in, so they go up on the roof, they break up the roof and lower him down to where Jesus was. And Jesus was impressed, and he saw their faith. And he spoke to the man first, said, "Your sins are forgiven you." Now, there were Pharisees in the crowd who thought, well, you can't say that because only God can forgive sins. Who do you think you are, God? And Jesus said, well, what do you think would be easier for someone like me to say? Your sins are forgiven you, or tell this paralyzed man to get up and walk? Now, of course, both are about equally easy to say, but one is much more risky to say. Because if I say your sins are forgiven you, I'm claiming to have some authority, but no one can tell if I have it or not. Maybe your sins are now forgiven, maybe they're not. No one can prove me wrong. But if I say to a lame man, a paralyzed man, get up and carry your bed and walk, I'm risking something there, because if he doesn't do it, I look stupid. I can say your sins are forgiven you, and I'll never look stupid for that, because no one knows if it was true or not. No one can tell. But it's harder, more risky, to say, get up and walk. And he says, so that you'll know that the Son of Man has power on earth, or authority on earth, to forgive sins. He said to the man, get up and walk, and he did. Now notice Jesus again talking about his authority in this case to forgive sins. Jesus came as Lord, as King. He's establishing the kingdom of God, and what a king is about is authority. Authority means the right to rule, and Jesus demonstrated his authority in his teaching, in his casting out demons, in his stilling storms. He has authority over even the weather. And now he says he has authority to forgive sins, and he proves it by doing a healing, which he said is designed to show you that. Now, when Jesus did miracles of healing, we have to understand he wasn't just doing this for the things, reasons we might think. When you know somebody who's sick that you care about, you think, well, if I could heal them, I certainly would do it. Because you want to stop their suffering. You don't want to lose them. You have compassion on them. And Jesus had compassion on the sick too, about five times. in Matthew, it says Jesus was moved with compassion, at least in the older translations. I'm not sure what the new RSV says. But he was moved with compassion. But he didn't heal everybody. There are towns he went into where he did heal everybody who was brought to him, but there were other places he went where he left people sick. The man that was healed at the beautiful gate of the temple in Acts chapter 3 by the apostles. Jesus had been through there many times just a few weeks earlier and hadn't healed him. Lazarus was sick, and he was a good friend of Jesus, and Jesus didn't heal him. He let him die. Some people say Jesus healed everybody. No, he didn't. When Jesus ascended to heaven, there were still a lot of sick people in Israel where Jesus had been ministering. He did heal all kinds of sicknesses where he went, and in some towns, no doubt, every person who was sick came and got healed, but not everyone. His healing, or his raising the dead, let us say. He didn't raise all the dead he could have. He raised Lazarus, he raised Jairus' daughter, he raised the widow's son of Nain, and that's all that we know about. He could have, no doubt, gone to every graveyard and called all the dead out, and that'd be great, but he didn't. The miracles Jesus did were not wholesale relief from all afflictions, from all sickness, from death, and so forth. He did these things as signs. These things were to demonstrate something. That's what he said before he healed the paralyzed man. So that you will know that I have a certain authority to forgive sins, which is an entirely different thing than healing sickness. But you can't see my authority to forgive sins, but you can see if I heal the sick or not. So you'll know I have that authority. I'm going to heal this man. And he healed him. The things Jesus did healing people were signs of his own spiritual authority. In the Gospel of John, which you'll study a few weeks from now, there are only 7 miracles of Jesus recorded. And there are also 7 sayings where he begins, I am. I am the door of the sheepfold. I'm the good shepherd. I'm the true vine. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the resurrection and the life. There's 7 I am sayings in John, and there's 7 miracles recorded in John. Interestingly, they link up in most cases. He said, I am the light of the world, and he healed a blind man. He said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He said, I'm the bread of life. And he fed multitudes with bread and fish. Now, what he's saying is, I'm doing these miracles, feeding the multitudes, raising Lazarus, healing a blind man. But what this is about is not simply that I don't want anyone to be sick. It's that what I'm doing is a visible demonstration of who I am. By giving this blind man sight, I'm showing I am the one who gives light and sight to the world. I'm the light of the world. By raising this one dead man, I'm demonstrating that I know what I'm talking about when I say I'm the resurrection and the life. I'm the life giver. By feeding these multitudes, I'm not alleviating all poverty and all hunger in the world. I'm making a demonstration to you that I am the bread of life. I'm the one who feeds you. I'm the one who gives you the bread that endures to eternal life. In other words, what Jesus is saying, and I think all of John's recorded miracles of Jesus have this purpose. Even the turning water into wine shows that he's the true vine. What does a vine do? It takes water and turns it into wine, ultimately. That's what vines are for, to make wine. Jesus turned water into wine. He's the true vine. What Jesus did, he doesn't turn water into wine very often. I don't know if he's ever done it again. But he did it that time and demonstrated something about himself. The miracles Jesus did were not simply his manifestation of his compassion for all suffering, because many people still were suffering when he left. But they were showing in visible ways what he was, his own identity. In Isaiah 53, it says, he himself bore our sicknesses and carried our sorrows or our pains. This is quoted in Matthew 8:17 of the time when Jesus healed all the people of Capernaum. Now, he healed all the people who were brought to him this Sabbath evening, or the night after the Sabbath, I should say. And it tells us he cured all who were sick, and then it says in verse 17, this was done to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took our infirmities and bore our diseases. That's a quote from Isaiah 53:4. He took our sicknesses, carried our diseases. When? Now, some people say he did that on the cross. That's not what Matthew says. Matthew says he did it in Capernaum that night. When he healed, he was carrying their, he was alleviating, lifting their burdens of sickness off them. Why would he do that? Because the next verse in Isaiah says, he was bruised for our iniquities. He was crushed for our transgressions. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Now this healing that he brings is spiritual healing. It's the chastisement for our peace with God. He was bruised for our transgressions. His stripes, his chastisement, his suffering brings our healing. That is our relationship with God. A theme that's in Isaiah throughout the book of Isaiah, and also mentioned Jeremiah and Hosea, that God says, I'll heal their backslidings. Their relationship with God, they're alienated from God, is going to heal that. And Peter even quotes that verse, Isaiah 53:5. He says, by whose stripes you were healed, because you were like sheep going astray, and now have returned to the shepherd and bishop of your souls. The last verse in 1 Peter 2. He says, "You by his stripes you were healed." What do you mean? Well, you were like sheep going astray. You've now returned. That's the healing. The healing is the relationship. He's healed your backslides, your wanderings. Messiah is the one who would heal Israel's relationship with God. In order to show that he was that healer, he bore actual sicknesses and pains in a one-to-one situation. The healings he did of physical sicknesses were the evidence that he is the one who's going to heal Israel's broken relationship with God, which was predicted in the same passage of Isaiah. Isaiah 53, verses 4 and 5 are both quoted in the New Testament. Verse 4 is quoted as being fulfilled when Jesus did the miracles of healing in Capernaum. Verse 5 is quoted with reference to the healing of our relationship with God. The one is a picture of the other. The healings and miracles Jesus did are pictures of who he is and what his mission was in terms of spiritual things that he came to accomplish and salvation and restoration to God. So Jesus, when he healed the paralytic, he said, that's so you'll know I have the power to forgive sins. And then we have him calling Matthew. This is the fifth disciple that Matthew mentions, and it's himself. He tells about his own call to be a disciple. He was a tax collector. In verse 9 through 13, Jesus walks by where he's working and says, follow me. He leaves everything and follows him. Now, why would he do that so suddenly? Well, this was in Capernaum where all these miracles were being done. Jesus was being talked about throughout the whole town. Matthew had been collecting taxes there at that booth. He's hearing people, do you hear that guy? He just healed, you know, a blind person. This guy just cast demons out of somebody. This guy just raised up a paralyzed individual with a word. Matthew's hearing all this. Certainly, he couldn't have missed it. But no doubt there was something in his heart that wanted to follow Jesus. We see so because as soon as Jesus invited him, he leapt at the chance. But probably he thought, I'm a tax collector. I'm an outsider. I'm viewed as a traitor to my people. I'd love to know this man Jesus. I'd love to follow this man Jesus, but I'm no doubt the type that he would have nothing to do with. Just like the Pharisees will have nothing to do with me. Most Jews will have nothing to do with me. And then Jesus walks by and says, why don't you follow me, Matthew? And he left everything and went just like that. You can tell he was primed for that. And he no doubt had been thinking about that, probably wishing that this would happen and could only dream it. And here Jesus does it. So he's so excited, he calls all his tax collector friends and has a feast at his house, invites Jesus. He wants all his tax collector friends to meet Jesus, which is what happens when people get saved. They want everyone they know to meet Jesus too. And, of course, Jesus gets criticized by the Pharisees, who won't have anything to do with this kind of rabble. But Jesus is hanging out with the wrong element. He's a friend of tax collectors and sinners. And the Pharisees criticize him for that, and Jesus says, well, those who are well don't need a physician, but those who are sick, I haven't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And then he goes on to say, you don't put a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, or else it's going to shrink and tear away from where you sewed it on. And you don't put new wine in old wineskins. Now, I'm hoping you might know what that image is about. A wineskin was a bag made of goat skin. And it was used to ferment wine when it was new. When they crushed the grapes, they took the grape juice that was unfermented, put it in these wineskin bags, sealed it up. And as the wine fermented, it gave off gases which caused it to expand. The wineskin, because it was fresh goat skin, would stretch. It would expand to accommodate the growth of the wine itself, because wine is alive. That's why it grows. Water isn't alive. Wine is. That's when Jesus turned water into wine. See, water's good for washing, but that's just external. The water that Jesus turned to wine earlier in John's gospel was used for washing. It was in 6 water pots that were used for the Jews' washing, it says. The Jews' washing could only cleanse the outside, but you take wine in, and according to Scripture, wine cheers the heart. It says it twice in the Old Testament, that wine cheers the heart of man, and God too, it says. Wine changes you. Wine alters your consciousness. Water just cleanses you on the outside because it's not a living thing itself. It just washes off dirt. But wine is living. It grows. It expands. It has living organisms in it. And it once you take it in, it changes your heart temporarily. It gives joy to the heart, the Bible says. And so Jesus compares his movement with new wine that is a living thing. Now, you can put new wine in a new wineskin because it'll accommodate it, because it'll stretch. But an old wineskin is one that's already been used. It was used to ferment earlier batch of wine, and now it's all stretched out. It's brittle. It's not going to stretch anymore. It's not going to accommodate any change. It's brittle. So you don't put new wine that's going to change into a bag that's not going to change. You're just going to break the bag. It's going to burst it, and you're going to lose the wine and the bag. That's what he's saying. You don't put new wine into old wineskins. You have to get new wineskins for that. And what he's saying is, you guys are trying to contain what I'm doing in the inflexible structures of your religious ideas. Your legalistic, inflexible, brittle concepts of what it means to be religious, what it means to be spiritual, what it means to have a relationship with God. I've got something I'm bringing that's dynamic. It's new to you. And It will not be restricted by your rules and regulations. It's spreading. Judaism was supposed to spread to the Gentiles, but it didn't, because the Jews didn't like the Gentiles. Jesus was reaching out to the sinners, the ones the Jews wouldn't reach out to. He's reaching out to the Gentiles, like the centurion, which the Jews wouldn't. His movement is expanding beyond the boundaries of what Judaism did. And if they can't be flexible, then they can't be part of it. You can't have an inflexible religion containing a dynamic and living spirituality and movement. And that's what Jesus was bringing. He says, don't try to hem me in to your structures. I've got new wine here, and if I try to wed it to your religious ideas, it's going to destroy my movement and your ideas too. We don't want to break the bag and lose the wine. Let's just get rid of the old bag. Okay, so that's what he says to him. Then Jesus is asked if he would go and heal the daughter of a ruler of the synagogue, Jairus. One gospel says she had already died, and another gospel suggests she was near death. But Jesus went to raise her, and as he was on his way there, a woman with an issue of blood touched his garment, and she got healed. And Jesus said her faith had made her well. But then he went and he raised the daughter. So we see again miracles piled upon miracles here. And allowing himself to be touched by a woman with an issue of blood was an unclean thing. Another example of Jesus not caring about that. When she touched Jesus, it was from the back, and he didn't know who did it at first. He said, "Who touched me?" And she was afraid to tell him because she had done something that would be not okay. For someone unclean to touch someone who's clean was to defile them, but she had every faith that it would change her if she touched Jesus, and she was right. And she was afraid to tell Jesus she'd touched him, but when she finally found she couldn't be hid, he said, "Daughter, go in peace. Your faith has saved you, or has healed you." All right. Now, then we have in chapter 9, Jesus casts a demon out of a mute person. That's someone who couldn't speak, and once the demon leaves, they were able to, the person could speak. That's in verse 32 and 34. And, of course, that resulted in the Pharisees blaspheming. They had to explain these miracles somehow, especially the exorcisms. They said, he's doing it by the power of Beelzebub. Jesus doesn't take the occasion to rebuke them for that or correct them here, but they do it again in chapter 12, and he corrects them there, as we shall see. At the end of chapter 9, Jesus tells the disciples they need to pray for laborers to go to the harvest because there's a great harvest but not enough workers. But not only are they supposed to pray for it, they got to volunteer for it. Because he tells them to pray for it at the end of chapter 9, and then in chapter 10, he sends them. Be careful what you pray for. You say, God, send missionaries to Africa. He said, you available? You know, you have to be willing to put your money where your mouth is. If you believe something is the will of God enough for you to pray for it, you better put your efforts into it too, if God calls you to do that. And so he tells them to pray for more laborers, and then he sends them out as laborers. In chapter 10, the entire chapter is something Jesus said to them. At least it's represented as being said on the occasion that he was sending them out for this short-term outreach. But some of the things look far beyond that short-term outreach. For example, he tells them at the beginning that he's only sending them out to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, not to go to the ways of the Gentiles. He says that in verse 5 and 6. But later on, he tells them that they're going to be giving testimony before the Gentiles. In verse 18, you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. But that didn't happen on this short-term outreach. That happened later on in the book of Acts, after Jesus had gone back to heaven. We can see that his vision in his instructions here is extended beyond this immediate outreach. And so he tells them what they'll face right away, but then he kind of goes on, and at least the way Matthew has combined the material, talks about their outreaches that will take place at a later time in their life as well, including their martyrdoms. So moving on to chapter 11. In chapter 11, John the Baptist sends messengers asking if Jesus is the one who is to come or not. John is in prison at this point. He's been imprisoned by a Roman official, Herod, a Roman ruler. Now, the Messiah, as John and everybody else thought, was supposed to liberate Israel from the Romans. John had been very faithful in professing that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, so of course he and everybody else expected Jesus to do something about these Romans. But after that, John gets arrested by the Roman ruler and put in a Roman jail, and he actually ends up dying there. He doesn't get delivered. But while he's sitting in jail, he's starting to say, well, it doesn't seem like Messiah is doing anything about these Romans. And so he sends messengers to Jesus. Are you the one who's coming or not? Now, some people say, I don't believe John could have any doubts about this. He saw the dove, he heard the voice, and so forth. He wouldn't have any doubts. But you underestimate the power of doubt. You can see miracles one day and have doubts the next day. When you have very if you pray for like finances for an outreach or something like that, and then it suddenly comes and you say, wow, there is a God, you know? I'll never doubt him again. Of course, until the next time. It's amazing how much you can see and how much demonstration of the truth you can have, and yet our capacity to doubt is almost inexhaustible. And John was a human being. He's getting discouraged. Jesus, he had truly believed and had reason to believe Jesus is the Messiah, but Jesus didn't seem to be doing the Messiah thing. And this was at John's expense, because John was staying in prison only because Jesus was not throwing out the Romans. If Jesus would get rid of the Romans, John would be set free again. But the longer he sat in prison, the more it felt like Jesus wasn't doing the right thing. Now, it's possible that John didn't doubt that he was the Messiah. He may have just been trying to nudge Jesus along a little bit. But he says, are you the one who's coming or not? That might not be really saying, I don't think you are. It might be saying, if you are, you should be doing something about it. You know, it's hard to know exactly how he intended that. Some people think it wasn't even John who had the doubts, but only his disciples. Like his disciples said to John, I thought this guy Jesus was supposed to do something special. He's not doing anything. And then John said, well, go ask him about that. Knowing that Jesus would say something good that would convince them. You know, it's some think that John didn't have any doubts, but his disciples did. So he sent them to Jesus for themselves so Jesus could alleviate their doubts. In any case, we don't know why. We don't know all that John was implying, but we know that he was saying, I'm a little disappointed. You know, I said you were the guy, and you're not acting like the guy. Are you the guy or not? And Jesus said to the messengers, you go tell John what you see. Now, Jesus didn't just give him a yes or no answer. He just said, you go tell him what you see. You see the blind, they're seeing. The lame are leaping. The deaf are hearing. The dumb are speaking. The poor have the gospel preached to them. Now, by the way, all those things are in Isaiah's prophecies about what the Messiah would do. In Isaiah 35 in particular, and Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2. Those are messianic prophecies in Isaiah that said that those things would happen when the Messiah comes. So Jesus is not saying, yes, I am. He's basically saying, tell John what's happening and let him decide if this is what the Messiah is supposed to do or not. But then he says, and tell John this, and this is so poignant. He says, tell John, blessed is everyone who's not stumbled by me. John was being stumbled by Jesus not doing what he thought Jesus should do. And Jesus is basically saying, can you trust me about this? Blessed are you if you won't be stumbled. Trust me, I know what I'm doing. And I think that that's a really powerful thing, because so many times we have been mistaken about what Jesus is supposed to do. There's a lot of people who are raised up in the Word of Faith teaching and think they're not supposed to be sick after they say they're well. They're not supposed to be poor when they say they're rich. And it doesn't happen. Let's face it, it doesn't work because it's not true. It's not a biblical doctrine. But people are taught that it is. They say, where's Jesus? I've been confessing I'm well. Here I am dying of cancer. I've known very good friends who believe that doctrine. They died of cancer while they were confessing they were well. Sometimes their last words were, I'm healed. And then they were. But not as they thought. And that's just it. God's promises are true, but not always as we think. The Messiah was coming, but not necessarily in the way the Jews or even John thought. And when God acts differently than we think he should, there's the tendency to be stumbled. And Jesus says to John, to the messengers, you go tell John, blessed is he who doesn't stumble by me. In other words, I'm not going to tell you whether I'm the one or not, but I'll tell you what's going on here. You decide. And if that's not what you think I should be doing, trust me, I know what I'm doing. Don't stumble because of me. Just trust me, is basically what he's saying. And then the messengers went back, and Jesus denounced Tyre and Sidon he denounced Jewish cities and said that they were worse than Tyre and Sidon and Sodom, and said that all those cities are less guilty than the Jewish cities are that were rejecting him. Tyre and Sidon and Sodom, of course, pagan cities that never heard the preaching of the gospel. They were evil, and they came under God's judgment, but they didn't deserve it as much as the Jewish cities did, who did hear the gospel and rejected it. And at the end of chapter 11, he gives this statement that is very famous, and I think it introduces chapter 12 on purpose. Chapter 11, 28 says, come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, one of the most important concepts in the distinctives of the Jewish religion was the concept of rest. The Sabbath was the sign of God's covenant between Israel and God. He said so in the 31st chapter of Exodus. He said, keep the Sabbath, it's the sign between me and you. So what is the Sabbath? Rest. You just rest. You just don't work. Not only the Sabbath, but every holy day they had. The first day of every month, the new moons. They had to rest on those days too. When they had the festival weeks of the Passover and Pentecost and Tabernacles, these were feasts long. The first and last day of those weeks had to be rested on too. You'd end up resting, 52 Sabbaths, 12 new moons, that'd be about 64, and then six more, 70 days out of their year. They had to do nothing to rest. And this was depicted, it was commemorating two things. According to Exodus chapter 20, it's commemorating the fact that God had rested on the seventh day when he created the heavens and the earth. The other thing, Deuteronomy 5 says, they were doing it to remember that God had given them rest from their slavery in Egypt. But in any case, rest was a major theme of Judaism. And Jesus says here, you who are heavy laden, you who are burdened, come to me and I'll give you rest. What were they burdened by? They were burdened by the heavy load of rules and regulations that were put upon them by their Jewish teachers. Jesus actually rebuked the Pharisees in Matthew 23. But he said, you bind heavy burdens, grievous to be borne on men's shoulders, but you won't lift them yourselves. The teaching of the Pharisees put burdens of obedience to minutia and a whole bunch of rules, meaningless rules in many cases, that they had to keep. And it was a burden. People got the impression God is really hard to please. I probably never will have a good relationship with God because I can't do all these things. And Jesus said, I'll give you rest from that. Are you burdened? Are you heavy laden? I'll give you rest. You take my yoke upon you. You learn from me and you'll find rest to your souls. In other words, he's basically offering them a spiritual rest, which is the antitype of the Sabbath rest. Now, why do I say it's the antitype of the Sabbath rest? The Sabbath rest was a type of this spiritual rest. Because the very next two stories that Matthew gives are about the Sabbath and about how Jesus didn't go along with the Jewish ideas of the Sabbath. In the first part of chapter 12, verses 1 through 8, Jesus' disciples are walking through a grain field, and it's the Sabbath, and they pick grain off the stalks, and they rub it in their hands and eat it on the Sabbath. Now, the Pharisees say, your disciples are doing what's unlawful to do on the Sabbath. Now, what was unlawful? That they were picking grain that wasn't theirs? If I walk through somebody's garden and start picking their vegetables and eating them, I'm stealing. But that's not what the problem was here, because the law in Deuteronomy 24 actually said that if a Jew went through the grain field of somebody else, they could pick ears of grain and eat it. They just couldn't bring a basket and you know, take a bushel home with them. But if you're hungry, you can eat somebody else's grain if you're walking through the field. So the law actually gave permission for that. That's not what the Pharisees were complaining about. They were complaining about the fact that they were harvesting grain and winnowing it, that's separating wheat from chaff to eat it, on a Sabbath. Those are work. That's work. That's not very much work, what they were doing, just pick a head of grain and rub it, but it was still harvesting and winnowing, and that's work, and you're not allowed to do that on the Sabbath. And Jesus said, have you not read what David did when he was hungry and how he ate the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, but only for the priests? Now, what he's saying is what my disciples are doing is apparently comparable to what David did. If you're not going to blame David for what he did, you shouldn't blame my disciples for what they did. And then he says, and have you not read that the priests profane the Sabbath every Sabbath day and are blameless? Now, what's that mean? Well, the Sabbath day, you're supposed to not do any work. You're supposed to do your regular work 6 days a week and rest on the seventh day. What did the priests do? They did their work 7 days a week. At the temple, they offered sacrifices every weekday, and they offered twice as many on the Sabbath. They didn't stop working on the Sabbath. He said the priests, they profane the Sabbath. They treat it like a normal day, and they're blameless. Now, of course, the Pharisees would have an answer for that. They'd say, well, that's different. They're working at the temple. The temple's work is important, and therefore, it's okay for them to do the temple work on the Sabbath. But then Jesus anticipated that answer, but one greater than the temple is here. What he's saying is, I'm greater than the temple. If it's okay for the priest to break the Sabbath because the temple work is that important, then it's okay for my disciples to break the Sabbath because my work that they're on my mission, is more important. Jesus is essentially saying that he is above the Sabbath, and he actually ends up saying in verse 8, for the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. So, he's the Lord of every day, including the Sabbath. And a disciple's duty is to just do what the Lord says, regardless what day of the week it is. The duty of a Christian is no different on the Sabbath than any other day. We're supposed to be doing God's work all the time, just like the priest in the temple did God's work all the time. Jesus is more important than the temple, and we're on his mission every day, 24/7. And so it doesn't matter if it's the Sabbath or not. All days are alike. If Jesus is your Lord, you're just doing what he wants. Now, in this passage, he said to them, he quoted Hosea 6:6 in verse 7. He says, if you had known what this means, I desire mercy, not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. Now, Hosea 6:6 says, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. And this is not the first time Jesus quoted this. Back in chapter 9, he quoted it to them. When they criticized him for eating with tax collectors and sinners, he said, you should go and learn what this means. I will have mercy, not sacrifice, quoting Hosea. And now he says, if you had learned what this means, I will have mercy, not sacrifice, you wouldn't have made this mistake again. You Pharisees keep making the same kind of mistake, and it's because you don't know what the scripture says. In Hosea, I will desire mercy rather than sacrifice. What God's saying is sacrifice is ceremonial law. Mercy is love, which is a moral obligation. Love is really what God wants more than anything else. He's more concerned about you loving your neighbor than he is concerned about whether you offer the animal sacrifices. Now, it's not that he didn't want both. Like when Jesus said to the Pharisees, you pay your tithes, but you neglect the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. And he says, you should have done these and not leave the other undone. You should do both. You should do the lesser and the greater. But if you're going to neglect one, don't neglect the greater one. And he said, even your own scriptures tell you that God desires mercy more than he desires sacrifices, and yet you're meticulous about sacrifices and you don't have very much mercy. What he's saying is you need to do the loving thing and not worry so much about ritual law. And in saying that, he's making it clear that Sabbath is a ritual law. He compares it with David eating the showbread. Is showbread a moral or a ritual law? It's a ritual law, not a moral law. What about the priest in the temple? That's ritual. Jesus is saying that Sabbath keeping is a ritual of the Jews, just like the showbread, just like the work of the temple, just like sacrifice. It's ritual. And God desires some things more than he desires that. He desires that you be merciful. And therefore, just as the priest was merciful to David and gave him the showbread, which the ritual law would say he couldn't eat, but David was in need. So my disciples are hungry here. Sure, maybe technically, maybe they are breaking the Sabbath, but just like David broke a law. Jesus specifically says David ate the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat. In other words, David did break a law. So did my disciples. It's similar. Now, by the way, people who are Sabbatarians, like Seventh-day Adventists, they say the disciples weren't really breaking the Sabbath. They were just breaking the Pharisees' interpretation of the Sabbath. They were violating the traditions of the Sabbath, not the law itself. Well, if that was true, Jesus could have said that. That would have been easier to say. He could have said, they're not breaking the Sabbath. What do you mean they're breaking the Sabbath? That's just your traditions. They're not breaking the Sabbath. That would be a good defense if it was true. Instead, he said, they're like David, who did break a law. They're breaking a law like David did, but like David, it's a ceremonial law, and it's being broken in the interest of human need. They're hungry. They need food. That's more important to God than keeping ceremonial laws. By the way, if Jesus had felt that his disciples had not broken the law, but were just breaking traditions, he could have treated it the way he treated the situation in Matthew 15, where the disciples were criticized for not washing their hands properly, which was a tradition of the rabbis. And Jesus just said, you guys, that's a tradition. He defended his disciples not washing their hands because that washing hands was a tradition. He didn't defend them in this case like that. He defended them by saying, this is not the only case of people breaking the law and being guiltless. And so Jesus makes it clear that they really were breaking the Sabbath, but that was not a problem because they were under his supervision. They were doing the work of him, and he's worth more than the temple. If the priest can break the Sabbath on the temple, then his disciples can break the Sabbath when they're doing his work. Because he's the Lord of the Sabbath. Now the next story is also about the Sabbath. A different Sabbath, another Sabbath day, in verses 9 through 14, says, he left that place and entered their synagogue. A man was there with a withered hand. They asked him, is it lawful to cure on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him? The law, of at least the way it had been interpreted by the Jews, said that a doctor whose normal work was to cure sicknesses or do what he could to do that, he could do that 6 days a week, but not on the Sabbath. The only exception would be if a sickness was life-threatening, if the patient would die before the end of the Sabbath, then they could make an exception. They could cure a person on the Sabbath if that person wouldn't live to the next day otherwise. But a withered hand, not exactly life-threatening. This man had been in this condition for many years and could probably wait to the next day. Jesus paid no attention to the Sabbath law. This is what probably got him crucified more than any other thing. The Sabbath law was the defining thing that made Jews different than Gentiles. Jews kept Sabbath, Gentiles did not. It was the sign of their covenant with God. And Jesus just flaunted it. Or I should say flouted it. He flouted the Sabbath law, and he flaunted his disobedience. If you don't know the difference between those two words, look them up. He flouted the law of Sabbath, and he flaunted it that he did so. And then he answers further. He said to them, suppose one of you has only one sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath. Will he not lay hold of it and lift it out? How much more valuable is a human being than a sheep? So it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. Now that's an important statement. For people to say, well, you got to keep the Sabbath. Well, what did Jesus say? What is lawful to do on the Sabbath? What's not? Doing good is lawful on the Sabbath. Well, what am I supposed to do the other 6 days? Bad? No, I'm doing good is always the right thing to do. Being bad is never okay. In other words, the Sabbath is no different than any other day. If you're doing good, it doesn't matter whether it's the Sabbath or not. It's 24/7 your obligation is to do good, including the Sabbath day. And so he told the man, stretch out your hand. He stretched out. It was restored as sound as the other. But the Pharisees went out and conspired against him how they might destroy him. So here we have, I think, the first time Matthew mentions plots against Jesus' life, which, of course, eventually succeeded in the end of his lifetime. Now, I'm not going to cover, because of our time limits, a lot of things here that are actually found in other Gospels. We want to turn to the parables of chapter 13. Now, I mentioned before that chapter 13 contains seven parables. Some might say eight if they include the one about the householder. But in any case, it's a collection of parables. Most of these parables are found in either Mark or Luke or both, but not all in one place. Matthew seems to have gathered them into a collection of parables of the kingdom. And like I say, you'll find most of them in the other Gospels, so we won't deal with those ones in detail. The parable of the sower and the soils, that's found in Mark chapter 4 and Luke chapter 8. The parable of the mustard seed, I believe, is found in Mark, if I'm not mistaken. Some of these parables are found elsewhere, but one parable that's in this chapter that is not found elsewhere is the parable of the wheat and the tares. Both the parable and its explanation are included in Matthew, whereas neither are found in the other Gospels. So I'd like to look at those, if we could. Verses 24 through 30 of chapter 13. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds, or tares is the right word. It's a specific plant, not just a generic thing for weeds. It's a plant that looks a lot like wheat, but it's really toxic. You can't eat it. Among the wheat, and they went away. The plant is called bearded darnel in modern speech, but in the King James it was called tares. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, an enemy has done this. The slave said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them out? And he replied, no, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both then grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. Now, a little later, he explains this parable, beginning at verse 36. Says, then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed are the children of the kingdom, which would be the disciples of Jesus. The weeds are the children of the evil one. By the way, Jesus told the Jews in John 8:44 that they were children of the devil. But there are Gentiles who would be fitting that category also. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone who hears, has ears, listen. The end of the age is an expression found a number of times in the Gospels. And in some cases, it appears to refer to the end of the Jewish age, like when the temple was destroyed in AD 70. There are times in the teaching of Jesus where the end of the age appears to be a reference to the end of the age they were living in at the time, which was the temple, the Second Temple Judaism age, the age of the Second Temple, the Jewish law age, the First Covenant age. And that did come to an end in AD 70. And Jesus said the harvest is the end of the age. But there are other times when it would appear that a different age is in mind, the end of the age meaning the end of the new age that would come, in which is the kingdom age, which is what Jesus inaugurated and still goes on to this day. In context, you have to kind of decide, is this talking about the end of the Jewish age or the end of the kingdom age? Because both are ages that the Bible speaks about. I personally think this is referring to the end of the kingdom age, the end of the world, when Jesus returns. I know people who take it the other way, and I can see their point. But the reason I don't think this is talking about what happened in Jerusalem in 70 AD is because the field that is to be cleared is not Israel, but is the world. He said the Son of Man was the one who sowed the good seed, the devil sowed the bad seed, the field is the world. And so he seems to be thinking of a global situation where there are children of God and children of the devil living alongside each other in this world. And some people think it might be a good idea to go through and get rid of the bad people. There would be people, hopefully not very many in the church, but some who'd say, you know, we ought to outlaw all this non-Christian stuff. You know, in America, where I live, a lot of people thought for centuries that America was a Christian country. And when you find Muslims and Hindus and atheists and so forth, and people living moral lives that are immoral to the Christian, a lot of people say, we need to get back and, you know, reestablish the Christian roots of this country and so forth. And you have to think, well, what do they mean by that? Are they going to go through and remove all the tares? How do you do that? Arrest them? Put them in jail? Shoot them? What do you do? I mean, how do you turn a worldly nation into a Christian society? You don't. God has so arranged things that in this world, there will be at the same time Christians and non-Christians, children of God and children of the devil. At the end of the age, that'll be settled. They'll be sorted out. But in the meantime, it's not our place to try to get rid of the non-Christians. The Christians are not supposed to have a political party or a militia or something to go and try to wipe out the non-Christians and set up a Christian, empire here. That's not the right way to think. And yet people have done that. Certainly the Catholic Church tried to do that. They tried to hunt down all the heretics and subject them to the Inquisition, burn them at the stake and whatever, because, you know, there's tares among the wheat here. Let's go uproot them. The man says, no, don't do that. You might uproot some of the wheat doing that. You might think something is a tare and it might really be wheat, and then you ruin some of the good grain. Actually, in the Inquisition, I think that the Roman Catholics did kill a lot of people who we would call Christians, or whom God would call Christians. The Waldenses and others were what we would call evangelical Christians, but they were called heretics by the Catholic Church. And so, you know, those who want to set up a Christian political empire by getting rid of the heretics, by getting rid of the false ones, by getting rid of the devil's people, they always end up making a mistake of who the devil's people are and who God's people are. It's not ours to be making those decisions. It's not ours to be settling those issues. That'll be done by the angels at a time at the end. And at the time of the end, the angels will go forth and they'll remove the wicked from among the righteous. This is another reason I don't think this is talking about 70 AD, because what happened in 70 AD is the righteous left Jerusalem and escaped, and then the wicked were left and killed. But it's talking here not about the removal of the righteous, but of the wicked. The tares will be gathered first. The weeds will be gathered first. They'll be removed from among the righteous. By the way, that also doesn't look like a pre-trib rapture to me either. Not to raise controversies unnecessarily, but in a pre-trib rapture, it's the righteous who are removed. But in this parable, at the end of the age, it's the wicked who are removed. and the righteous remain and shine as the stars or as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Remember, Jesus said the meek are going to inherit the earth. It's the wicked that will be rooted out of it. It says that also in Proverbs chapter 2. Again, not to get too much on a rabbit trail, and I'm going to give you another break here in just a few minutes, but in Proverbs chapter 2, there's never any hope in the Old Testament of the righteous going away to heaven, but of the wicked being removed and the righteous inheriting the earth. You see that, for example, in Proverbs 2, 21 and 22, the last two verses there. For the upright will abide in the land, the innocent will remain in it, the wicked will be cut off from the land, and the treacherous will be rooted out of it. So the wicked are the ones removed, and the righteous are the ones who inherit the earth. And so Jesus said that the angels will come, they'll remove the wicked, take them out, and then the righteous will remain in the kingdom of their Father and shine forth. There's another parable in this chapter that makes the same point using simply a somewhat different imagery, and that is about the dragnet. And it's in verse 47, Matthew 13:47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from among the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire. And there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Same thing happened to the tares. They're thrown into the furnace of fire. The idea here is that at this point, he's not only pointing out that the good and the bad are growing in the world together, but even the good and the bad are being gathered together through probably the preaching of the gospel, the net that's dragging them in. The disciples were called to be fishers of men, and they're out there evangelizing, bringing in the fish. Some bad ones come with the good. We'll see that also in Matthew 22, when the wedding feast is furnished with guests, but some of them came without wedding garments, had to be thrown out. I think Jesus is saying that just as the world itself will have good and bad together in it until the end, the church itself is going to gather in some bad along with the good. But they will be sorted out at the end. The angels will do that. Then we read of Jesus at the end of 13 going to his hometown Nazareth and preaching there, but he's not well received. And so he leaves there, and he marvels at their lack of faith. Now, we're not going to go any further now. We're going to take a break. We'll come back. And I'm going to skip over a lot, of course, because we'll only have a little over an hour. And I'm going to look at the Olivet Discourse, at least because I've been told that some people are looking forward to that particular treatment.